Hello. Hello, good morning. Ladies and gentlemen, friends and colleagues. My name is Raquel Bouso. I'm an associate professor of philosophy at the University of Miyahara in Barcelona, Spain. And I'm delighted to be here today to lead or share this roundtable. And first of all, our topic to discuss is Japan and the cultural disarmament of philosophy. But first of all, I'd like to introduce you our speakers. Professor Yasunari Takada is a professor emeritus at the University of Tokyo. He formerly was an associate professor of English literature at Tohoku University from 1982 to 1989. Also, he was associate professor and full professor of comparative literature and cultural representations at the University of Tokyo. His publications include Cicero, An Intellectual Tradition in Europe, Transcendental Descent, Essays in Literature and Philosophy. Another publication is Critical Moment, Origins of Criticism and Recognition of Liminality. Among other titles, there is Chaucer's Use of Neoplatonic Traditions and one of the last books, Translatio and Difference, Western Classics in Modern Japan. Thank you very much for being here. Other speaker that we have today is John Maraldo, really very well known by all of you. John Maraldo is a distinguished professor emeritus of philosophy of the University of North Florida. He earned a Bachelor of Arts in Philosophy from the Catholic University of America in 1964, and a doctorate on philosophy from the University of Munich in 1970 with a dissertation entitled Der Hermeneutische Wirkel, Urteilsschwungen zu Schleiermacher, Dilthe und Heidegger, which was published later in Paraderle. Then he spent several years in Japan teaching and studying Japanese philosophy and Zen Buddhism. He taught at Sophia University in Tokyo, at Naropa University in Boulder, Colorado, and the University of Southern Illinois, before going to Florida in 1980. In the interim, he was a guest professor at the University of Kyoto and the Catholic University in Leuven, Belgium, and in 2008, from 2008 to 2009, held the Roche Chair in Interreligious Research in Nanzan University in Nagoya, Japan. His interests include comparative philosophy, phenomenology, and hermeneutics, and Japanese philosophy in general, and more particularly, the thought of Nishida, Nishitani, Kuki, and Katsuji. He has been working on Buddhist notions of history and of practice, and the sense and significance of non-Western philosophy. In addition to numerous articles in these areas, he has published a translation and a study of Heidegger, The Piety of Thinking, together with James Hart in 1976, was published, Buddhism and Modern World, collected with Heinrich Dumoulin. Next, Root Awakenings, then the Kyoto School and the Question of Nationalism, collected with James Heisek, and several essays in the series Frontiers of Japanese Philosophy. His most recent books, his most recent book in singular, is Japanese Philosophy, a Source Book, co-edited with James Heisek and Thomas P. Kasulis. It was from 2011 published. The University of North Florida recently honored him by establishing the John C. Maraldo Annual Lecture in Comparative Philosophy, first delivered in 2009. Thank you all very much, Thomas, for coming here. Our next speaker is Rein, born in 1961, graduated from St. Petersburg the University on Japanese Studies in 1985, PhD in Helsinki in 1994 in literary theory. Is one of the founders of the Estonian Humanities Institute in 1989, and he has been working in various capacities until and beyond its merger into the Tallinn University, of which he was the first rector from 2006 to 2011. Professor of Japanese Studies at the University of Helsinki from 1995 to 2016. He has published numerous books and studies in Japanese and comparative philosophy, mostly involving Dogen. Also, classical Japanese literature and cultural theory. Notably and recently, his book, Meaning in Action, Outline of an Integral Theory of Culture, recently published by the Press Polity in Cambridge. Renaud is also author of fiction, author of one novel, The Brother, and this novel has been published in English also, and two more forthcoming. In addition, he has made a lot of translations from many languages and has published several essays. Thank you very much, Renaud, for being here and sharing with us this roundtable. And last but not least, Professor Miyahara Isamu. He's professor at the Graduate School of Letters, you know, Humanities Department, in Nagoya University, as far as we know, yes. And his research interests include phenomenology, contemporary philosophy, philosophical theory of language, cognitive linguistics, and he has been working mostly on ethics. He has taken part in several research projects, and among his publications can be mentioned his article published in the Monist Journal about communicative universals. Also, he has published The Philosophical Foundation for Cognitive Linguistics and Reconstruction of Phenomenology. So, thank you so much again for being here and taking part in this roundtable. The title of the roundtable talks about cultural disarmament. And this expression, according to Raymond Panikkar, the Catalan philosopher, entails a criticism of culture, a radical examination of the way ideas have been shaped by practices and institutions. And it can be done only within an intercultural philosophy or framework, according to Panikkar. How can this be applied to philosophy, this idea of cultural disarmament, and what kind of role can play Japan on it? This would be our starting point. Of course, most of us dealing with the topic of Japanese philosophy as a way of focusing our research interests, we have faced the difficulty in studying Asian philosophy in general, or Japanese philosophy in particular. The problem that Asian traditions were not continuous with the ancient Greek tradition from which philosophy takes its name and its aims. This tradition certainly had no equivalent term to the Greek philosophia, love of wisdom. And in modern times, of course, several names have been invented to express the idea, like the tetsugaku, in Chinese. In Indian philosophy, darshan is also used, though the original meaning of the word is not the same as philosophy, but this word is used from what we used to understand by philosophy. But we should, before engaging this discussion, probably first consider the question of just what philosophy is. Having this in mind, I would like to take as a starting point for our discussion this idea, which is in the title of the roundtable, about cultural disarmament of philosophy. What does it mean for you? And why do you think it would be worth to engage in this cultural disarmament of philosophy. First, perhaps, John, would you like to start the discussion? Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. First of all, I want to thank the organizers of the whole conference for getting us together and organizing a panel discussion to open the conference with. And I'd like to thank all of you for attending. And I'd like to remind you that after we panelists speak, the discussion is open to everyone. And so we look forward to your participation, too. So I want to say just a few words first about the idea of cultural disarmament and the disarmament of philosophy. So what do these words imply? It implies that philosophy is a kind of it's a kind of armed force or an armed fortress that needs to be disarmed, perhaps in order to open it up to non-standard approaches and sources, and to disarm it of its hegemony in the academy, in universities. So I'm going to try to look at that from a slightly different perspective, because I think that philosophy in the universities is already quite endangered, and it doesn't need our disarmament. It needs our reinforcement and our reform. And that's because, for example, in the United States, about the only place that philosophy plays any role at all is in universities and colleges. Philosophy has almost no role in public life. The people outside the universities and even people inside the universities are, for the most part, ignorant of philosophical discussions. And to a certain extent, that's also the fault of what's being done in philosophy departments. I'm not sure how it is in other countries, but philosophy is endangered as a discipline in universities and colleges and in public life, particularly in the United States, at a time when we need more critical thinking than ever, as is evident, for example, in the last presidential election in the United States, where even journalists say things like there are no facts, as if that were somehow a fact. We have little public discussion of what truth means, of what justice, responsibility, ideas like that, which are core ideas in philosophy. They play almost no role in public journalism and public life, particularly, well, I would have to perhaps limit myself more to the United States, but I wonder if this is not also the case in other countries. Philosophy as an academic discipline, I think, is imperiled. It's endangered both internally and externally. Internally, philosophers have become more and more specialized somehow to keep up with the natural sciences. They become so specialized that their language and their approaches are nearly unintelligible for people working outside of their own specialization. And this is really an unfortunate situation. An example would be, for example, logical theories of truth, which are, I attended, for example, a conference several years ago in Leuven on logical theories of truth, and I have some training in logic and in notions of truth, but I myself was totally unable to follow the discussions. The language had been so super specialized. So I think this is really an indication that philosophy is slowly disintegrating as a discipline that can communicate to people in public life. So it's become extremely over-specialized, again, I think in order to compete with the natural sciences, which somehow unquestionably are the standard bearer for what counts as reality and truth. Now, there are some positive signs. There are, for example, there is a position at Harvard now in public philosophy, which is being assumed again by Cornel West. There's a kind of revolt group going on. It's mostly an internet group called Against Professional Philosophy in the United States, and it publishes online an anarcho-philosophical diary. And in other countries, too, for example, in France, there's the work of Michel Henry and his Université Populaire. And even here at this university, there is, I think, the group, what is it called, d'études cartésiennes, which is very encouraging to me. At Harvard, another positive sign that students want more than what is usually offered in academic philosophy. A good sign of that is that the third most popular course at Harvard right now is a course in Chinese philosophy. It's taught by Michael Pewitt, who has published a book called The Path, What We Can Learn from Chinese Philosophy. And he says that the students are extremely hungry for something different from what is taught in any other courses. They're looking for something that can tell them how to live a good life and what a good life might mean. Something apart from job training, from the drive to that the only thing that's important is to have a job, earn money, to be able to live well in capitalistic systems. So these, I think, are positive signs, but still within the philosophy departments, we find a great deal of contention and stress and competition, rivalry among different approaches. For example, analytic philosophy versus continental philosophy, or within continental philosophy, we have phenomenologists fighting with postmodernists and so on and so forth, and they're struggling for funding as well. And so they are internally endangering themselves. But the endangerment comes also from outside the philosophy departments. It comes from the increasing emphasis, at least in the United States, on what are called STEM courses, the STEM curriculum, that is science, engineering, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, to the exclusion of the near exclusion of the humanities, of language studies, and certainly of philosophy. And I've heard also that humanities programs in Japan are endangered, except perhaps at the biggest universities, Kyodai and Todai, included at those universities. So this is not only an American phenomenon. I think it's so philosophy departments in the United States are gradually being eliminated or absorbed into other departments, other programs, and they're being downsized. It's of course, it's a good thing that philosophy is being mixed with other disciplines, but all of those disciplines together, I think, today find themselves on kind of a sinking ship. So this is really, I think, a way that philosophy is endangered from the outside. So the question then for us here is what we might be able to do about this. Now, the disarmament of philosophy is war talk. And I don't think we need war talk. I think we need integration. I think we need to show how what we do is relevant, not only to ourselves, but to others in the university and outside of the university. I think one way that we can do that is to show the strength and the relevance of what's called the wisdom tradition, largely a forgotten tradition in Western philosophy. It's been reinvigorated by the professor at Harvard and, of course, by the French philosophers Udall and by Foucault and people like that, but the wisdom tradition, I think, is stronger in Japanese traditions and in other Asian traditions than it has been recently in the United States. Because in Japan, for example, the intellectual discourse has always been put traditionally in the context of practical living and of liberation, and ideas like trust and truth and self-awareness even are understood in terms of practice and cultivation, even bodily practice. And I think these things are, as examples only, highly relevant for the rest of philosophy, something that philosophers can learn from us. The point then is that we need, I think, to expose what we're doing more, to integrate more, to expose what we're doing more to philosophers in other specializations, in other areas, in other approaches. We don't need to fight against them. We need to show them how philosophy can be expanded and reinvigorated. And there are, this is going on, for example, in Japan. There's the work of a person here, Morioka Masahiro, whose philosophy as a life study with its emphasis on relationship is extremely relevant for an alternative understanding of bioethics and environmental ethics. There's nothing particularly unique about what Japanese traditions perhaps have to offer. I think an encounter with any of the Asian traditions is extremely important. But the point is that we have to not only talk among ourselves and to ourselves, we need to talk to those philosophers whose life work is now endangered by these internal and external forces. I think it's extremely gratifying and energizing and exciting that here we have over 100 or almost 100 presentations. It's absolutely amazing to me to see this. And I want this to continue, but I would like especially the younger people here, the people who have to show that they have technical facility and that they can think with rigor, that they have something to say to these other philosophers whose discipline really is on its way out otherwise. So that's my main point to start off.
Thank you, John. Professor Yasunari Tanaka, please, would you like to add some comment to this?
Well, I have nothing to object, go against what John Maraldo said. It's everything is, I think, just, and I'm of the same opinion. And the philosophy, and including in a much wider sense, humanities in general, have been fast in decline for the past two decades or so. And we thought it was, we being Japanese, thought it was not a worldwide phenomenon. The Japanese felt we were the first to be in the sinking boat. But in a way, it's a kind of relief. Tragic relief to hear that you are also sinking and worldwide. But I've got no idea how to do that. Perhaps getting together and shout to the powers that be can be of some help, but perhaps not. Can I go on to my own kind of intervention, like John, or just kind of round table discussion? What is format would you like to have us?
we can start giving an overview of the situation as far as you understand
it. All right.
And then we can move to other
all
points.
Open discussion
to the public.
All right, okay. I'd be great if you'd give me 10 minutes or so. In the first place, the theme, cultural disarmament, I was just baffled. It's embarrassed to hear. What is it? And only when you gave me a note, it was the statement by a Spanish scholar, I've come to understand some. But still, it was very baffling. Still, I'm being baffled. Also, I'm baffled to find there's no round table, a square table here. But it's okay. And to make the argument concrete as possible, I'd like to give my own view about my own standpoint in the argument about this cultural disarmament. One of the liveliest talks of the nation in Japan these days is the self-abdication of the emperor. Perhaps you know that. The emperor took the unusual action of appealing directly to the public in a televised address that he might perhaps be allowed to resign from the emperorship, as he felt it more and more difficult as years went by to fulfill what he thought his duties as emperor as symbol. The emperor now is defined by the constitution as symbol, a very ambiguous position. The government in response has organized the special committee to deal with issue. In the nature of the things, the committee consists mainly of conservative-oriented members, some middle and a few ultra-right. One of these few ultra-right members expressed his opinion in public, something to the effect that the emperor is not allowed to abdicate on his own accord, particularly because tradition dictates that one of the essential duties of emperor is to pray for the people. And the act of praying can be done up until the last day. It's rather astonishing to hear this kind of blasphemous sounding remarks from an ultra-right intellectual. But anyway, the heart of the matter is that as an ultra-traditionalist, he would never admit any human rights with emperor, human rights to the emperor. To the best of my knowledge, a young constitutional scholar at the Tokyo Metropolitan University brought up the idea of human rights as one of the keywords for the entire controversy at its initial stage. But since then, the idea has somehow or other disappeared from the platform. But if you really come to think of it, it's strange, isn't it, that the idea of human rights did not prop up at the first step of the argument. For one of the most conspicuous and drastic changes the post-war emperorship has undergone is a change of status from emperor god in the pre-war period to emperor man in the post-war era. On January 1st, 1946, Emperor Hirohito, Emperor Showa, declared that he renounced his divinity, what is called in Japanese Ninyan Sangen. So it can be naturally assumed that from then on, the emperor is regarded as human, at least. It is true that November 3rd of the same year saw the proclamation of new constitution in which the emperor is designated a symbol of the Japanese people. But that doesn't negate some kind of human status declared back in January. The truth of the matter seems that we have not a precise definition yet of both elementary and principal status of emperor. This is an interesting issue worthy of consideration, considering in connection with cultural disarmament. But as a nature of cultural disarmament philosophy, more generally, it is more interesting to, perhaps it's more interesting is the sense in which the radical change of emperor's status took place. In what sense the radical change of emperor's status took place? The change from emperor as god in the pre and interwar period to the emperor as man and symbol in the post-war era. Now, in view of the incomparably significant role the man and God relationship, had to play in Christian culture of the West, it is surprisingly uncontroversial when the emperor regarded as God in the pre and pre-interwar period was suddenly declared emperor as man. The complete defeat and disaster of the war can explain the disarmed acceptance of the declaration, but there seems to be something more more fundamental to it than that. Well, I don't have to repeat what a standard textbook of philosophy, i.e. Western philosophy, tells about its origins and constitutional revolution. Roughly put, the modern philosophy is a consequential amalgam of three elements. One, Greek analytic dialectics. Second, Christian dynamics of transcendent aspirations and down-to-earth insistence. And third, modern process of secularization. It's true that without the Greek initiative, Western philosophy would never have been born, but it is perhaps more true to say that without the Christian dynamics of transcendent aspirations combined with down-to-earth valorization, i.e. the mystery of incarnation and the controversial question of God-man status, modern Western philosophy would never have been as robust in its conceptual formation and would never... modern philosophy would never have been as robust in its conceptual formation and would never have been as dynamic in its critical perspective as it stands. Endeavors have been done that apparent incompatibilities such as eternity versus here and present, here and now presence, infinity and the finite, ideal and practice, these incompatibilities be grasped as much as possible in conceptual terms. I surmise that many of you don't like Hegel, but his efforts in the direction of philosophical articulation of Christian dynamics deserve praise. I must hasten to add that I'm neither a Christian nor a lover of German idealism, but having learned a little about Western philosophy, I have to feel some dejection when I come to see the impassive attitude or even the nonchalant air with which the Japanese intellectuals have let pass what is supposed to be the drastic change from emperor's god to emperor's man. For this change harbors the possibility of being concerned not only with the political sphere, but also with epistemological and ethical dimensions. To put it simply, it is bound up with the fundamental posed by Kato Shuichi, suspicion that there is nothing outside and beyond emperor's system. Kato Shuichi suspected that there is nothing outside beyond emperor's system. If emperor is truly human, then there must be something outside and beyond emperor's system from which the system can be critically observed. In the meanwhile, 70 years after the emperor's declaration of being human, the opinion, albeit a few, is openly aired that emperor has no human rights. And it has become taboo of taboos to make a radical critique of the emperor's system itself. In the present Japan, what an eminent, what an eminent Wiener philosopher in Cambridge said about philosophical truth becomes actuality. In present Japan, what an eminent Wiener philosopher in Cambridge said about philosophical truth becomes an actuality. That is, of what we can't talk, we must keep silence. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's move to Professor Miyahara Isamu.
So I spent too much time to prepare my speech of tomorrow. So I will talk about two types of motivation for philosophy in Japan. At first, I would like to give a comment concerning a point which Professor Maraldo pointed out. So it is a contrast between academic phase, applied practical phase of philosophy, for example, bioethics and theory of justice, and theory of care, and so on. I also believe this kind of philosophical attempt should be very appreciated highly because of its practical usefulness. However, I would like to point out the situation why a lot of philosophers are compelled to embark on such a practical project. One of the reasons for that is a phenomenon of diminishing of importance of humanities in the university as well as in the whole society in Japan, especially. It is getting harder to appeal the importance of so-called academic training, which I'd like to call the hermeneutic training. For example, to read a lecture for the classical text, and so this situation is not so happy situation for a philosopher, because even the field of applied philosophy and applied ethics, such academic training, so-called hermeneutic training is needed and indispensable as a preparatory tool study for that application. So I'd like I will talk about two type of motivation for philosophy in Japan. So two type is one of them is very individualistic quest for the investigation of the essence of ego or a subject. So another one is the more wide another one has a more wide perspective. From which the relationship with other can be minutely investigated. So I think that the philosophy of Nishida Kitaro is one of the individualistic attempt to scrutinize the essence of human beings. So in my speech of tomorrow, I will talk about the such two the origin of historical origin of such two type of motivation for philosophy. Backyard the mainstream of to Mahayana Buddhism. So I think that I can find that in the depths of the philosophical thinking in Japan and content which has been derived from the another culture. I want to understand the concept of disarmament, cultural disarmament philosophy, a kind of positive power of philosophy. So I think that. Individualism of Nishida's philosophy is has such a kind of power of disarmament because his thinking his philosophy is not so popular among modern Japanese intellectual because I think our Japanese people has have to think the more communalistic thinking of others oriented way of thinking. So Nishida said by himself that he have been not well understood among Japanese people even in his student. His thinking is a very peculiar and quite different, not major way of thinking. So, of course, his thought is built under the influence of, for example, Kant or Thomas Higgins. Under the influence of culture of other countries. So now as you know well, that our Japanese philosophical thought is a kind of a result of a history of influence from other outer world. So in this sense, the philosophical thinking in Japan has a power of a positive power of disarmament. I want to mean under the such a concept, so a deeply critical thinking about its own culture, the way of thinking. So we can find a good example of a kind of disarmament in the philosophy of Nishida. So,
okay, thank you so very much. Let's now please hear Rein's views on the topic.
Thank you very much. I'd like to first of all join all the other speakers and in their expression of gratitude to the organizers of this conference for having us there and giving us the possibility of talking about this topic as a starting event. Just as an aside, I find it really weird that traditionalists would argue against the emperor's abdication, because I haven't counted, but I think there are more emperors in Japanese history who have abdicated, actually, than those who haven't, which just testifies to the declining level of the knowledge of history. If you look at what the Fujiwara clan did to emperors during the Heian times, I mean, as soon as they were able to, well, they were put on the throne when they were able to walk. As soon as they learned to speak, they were kind of abdicating already. You know, so you have these former emperors. Most of the time. So back to the topic. Yes, all of what John said is really true. Philosophy is declining, and I think the idea of academic philosophy as the only kind of philosophy is very much at fault. I would add an additional layer that the concept of philosophy is also being hijacked. Look at a corporate website and say, well, our philosophy is to put the client first. Really? Is that a philosophy? Or is this just an empty slogan, which you do not actually intend to keep? The word philosophy is losing its meaning in both sides. First of all, it's being like diluted in everyday speech, and it's being esotericized in the academic discipline. I have also seen some of the kind of events that that treats philosophy basically as a subdiscipline of mathematics, long mathematical formula and so on that, and if you don't read them, you're kind of like non-entitled. Already as the novelist Robert Pfirsich, I hope some of you are familiar with this work, has put it in his book entitled Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, which has as little on Zen as it has on motorcycle maintenance, but quite a lot about philosophy. Its main hero, at a certain critical point in life, decided that he wants to know about philosophy, and then he starts reading what people engaged in philosophy do, and he discovers that they are not doing philosophy at all. They're talking about philosophy. They're doing like history of philosophy. If you see about like a book that gives you an explanation of Hegel's logic, it's not philosophy. It's history of philosophy. It's a history of it's a study of Hegel and Hegel's work. While when you look at what Hegel taught when he was at the university, he taught, you know, discipline, something like, well, this year we are going to deal with philosophy of right, this year we are going to deal with the philosophy of history, or something like that. So he was actually engaged in philosophical inquiry into the much more important general questions, which had been the norm, that had happened before. Immanuel Kant and Königsberg did just the same. Well, this was what people did. Also, if you look at Heidegger's lectures are, well, they may be about some philosophers at some point as well, but the idea is not to find out what some philosopher has said. The idea is actually to think philosophically, which is something that is becoming extinct in academic philosophical departments. So it's no wonder that the concept of philosophy is being hijacked, because philosophers are giving that concept away of their own free will. Obviously, one of the problems is that if something becomes an academic discipline, then you're supposed to treat it as if it were a science. My favorite quote on the topic is by an obscure Russian thinker called Yakov Golosovker, who said, "Philosophy is the mother of all sciences, which means it cannot be a science itself, because you can't be your own mother." I find that there is a really, really deep idea in this, and therefore we should treat philosophy as a cultural activity or a cultural practice, which is not a science, which is not literature, which is not an art, but which is of itself, by itself, is the quest for a pure, unadulterated, unbiased knowledge of how the world works, and so on and so forth. I also share the criticism John voiced about professional philosophers. Let's engage in a little bit of philological deconstruction here. If philosophy is love of wisdom, then a philosopher is a lover of wisdom. A professional philosopher is a professional lover of wisdom. A professional lover, we normally call a prostitute. So prostitutes of wisdom are professional philosophers. So, And obviously, when these types are taking over the concept and the discipline of philosophy, and they are kind of governing it from their high pulpits in departments, this is where this cultural disarmament concept comes in. I wasn't aware of Raymond Panikkar's definition and quite different content that he gave to it. I thought that cultural disarmament means that disarmament means you're putting your weapons down, yes? So a cultural disarmament means putting your cultural weapons down, the weapons that culture has given to you, or using cultural reasons for putting your weapons down for whatever purpose. And I would say that the term cultural disarmament in a negative way describes fairly well the situation that these professional philosophical departments in so many universities are doing to themselves. They're denying, for example, that Japan has a philosophy or has had a philosophy. They say, no, philosophy is what comes from Greek and German, possibly this sub-math called analytical philosophy also qualifies, but Japan, no. India, no. You have wisdom, maybe, yeah, but philosophy, that's sort of ours. Why? Because obviously, otherwise, you would have to reconfigure the whole curriculum. You would maybe have to create more positions. Instead of having the third associate professor dealing with Hegel's aesthetics, you would have to create a position for, let's say, Indian philosophy, Chinese philosophy, Japanese philosophy, so that these would also be taught. And as a result, with these cultural arguments, Western academic philosophy is disarming itself. It is abstaining from legitimate lines of philosophical inquiry, from methods of philosophical thinking that I would like to argue are even more valid or up to date today or necessary today than they were even 50 years ago. So it's not even cultural disarmament, it's a cultural self-castration of philosophy that is going on in these academic departments. It's something that you could do something, but you don't, and you think of cultural arguments or very absurd arguments. Why I shouldn't do this. On the other hand, if we would say that Japanese philosophy would just be a kind of an intellectual curiosity, it's something that, they're the Japanese, they also have their own philosophy, they think it is important, they're good friends of ours, so maybe we should find out what they think. If that would be just on that level, then you could still say, well, we don't have the money, let's have this other professorship instead. But this is not the case, because the developments of science over the last 50, 60, 70 years have been huge, and they have radically altered the paradigm of how how the best available level of knowledge about the nature, about the way how the world is, can now be understood. And at the same time, ontology, the Western academic ontology, is still operating with concepts that are maybe 2 inches removed from Aristotle, but which still kind of are object-based at their core. There are certain new developments, certain new schools in Western philosophy as well, such as structural realism and so on, which is maybe a reconfiguration of scholastic realism in a certain way. But nonetheless, the questions of what is, how it is, and so on, has placed all these ideas of process philosophy and negativity somewhere on the fringes. It's not like the you're a little bit weird if you're engaged with these. So here, Japanese philosophy with its, I would say not just Japanese philosophy, but the whole heritage of East Asian philosophy and Indian philosophy, with a really thorough and convincing ways of argument or argumentation of such arguments or such views of reality as are not very well established in Western philosophical discussion could come to the help of these hitherto marginal voices on the Western philosophical landscape in order to help them to create discourses which would be much more adequate and much more intelligible and compatible with the results of what natural science has achieved until now than the received views of Western philosophy would be. So Japanese philosophy, as well as studies into Indian, Chinese, or any Buddhist philosophy in particular, have a very important job to accomplish in Western philosophy. And what should perhaps be a little consolation to us is that the paradigms of Western philosophy have changed, radically changed, repeatedly over the course of its development through the centuries. And when I... my favorite philosopher, Japanese philosopher, is Dogen, yes? So before Dogen was born, almost no one in the West, except some crazies, had ever heard of a man called Aristotle. Because Aristotle was this Greek, you know, guy. We don't read Greek. Latin is the language. And then some weirdos who were engaged in this Orientalist Eastern thing, they were reading Arabic, and they were reading stuff translated from Greek into Arabic. And then they had heard of Aristotle. This is, like, weird. And it took a little bit, like, more than 80 years before Aristotle started to be their philosopher, with a capital P, in the Western tradition. So it might take, like, no more than a couple of decades to totally overturn the edifice so that it can accommodate new lines of thought, new kinds of thought, and so on. And I sincerely believe that your work, our work in the research of Japanese philosophy, is something that could help to accomplish that task. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Let's now open the discussion to the audience. So if there is any question. First one. Comment, observation. Okay, who?
First.
Thank you.
Is it work? Yeah, it's working. So, hi everyone. So, talking about the philosophical disarmament, there is a channel on YouTube at the moment. I'm thinking especially about two American channels, School of Life and Wisecrack, the second one. And both of them are actually practicing philosophical disarmament, both in different ways. One of them is, so School of Life presents a philosophy, the key point of the philosophy of a big author, Hegel, Descartes, and so on. And then apply it to concrete subject, relationship, death. The title of the different videos are very, very practical most of the time. And the second channel take element of pop culture and try to see the deeper meaning. For example, they have a video such as the philosophy of Darth Vader, the philosophy of South Park, which is, in my opinion, very, very good, a very, very good way to get to, especially a young public, because you go from something they know and then you push them to see the philosophical side of them. So, yeah, I just wanted to recommend these two channels for people that are interested, actually, in philosophy and philosophy in everyday life.
Any other question or comment?
No, sir. If you can. That's okay, yeah. My name is Tatsuya Higaki from Osaka University, and thank you very much for John Maraldo and the other speakers. And I would like to know a very simple question. In this opening session, the theme is the disarmament philosophy in the situation of Japanese philosophy, in the situation in Japan. But I think that as the Professor Maraldo says, the kind of disarmament of philosophy is in now in all over the world. It's a problem with globalization and Anglo-Saxonization and mondialization of philosophy en français, en français un petit, et c'est mondialization de philosophy. So I would like to know what is the speciality in the case of Japanese philosophy. Or what is the specialty? What we can talk in the situation in Japan? That's my question, okay? And I think that it is just what Maraldo says. Overall the world, the same question is one can talk about the same question. But in Japan, especially, what is a very special situation? And that's my question.
And so,
well, it's simply, as I briefly touched on, the emperor system is the main issue. Yeah, and so I'd like to listen to what Mr. Raud said.
When we were preparing for this, we were asked, each of us, to present a question. Then the question that I sent in was something that has been troubling me, or not only about Japanese philosophy, but about Japanese cultural phenomena in general. And the question is that the word Japanese in the compound Japanese philosophy can have two different meanings. One meaning is the same as in the compound Japanese car. We know what a car is. Cars are manufactured everywhere. Japanese car is a car which has been manufactured in Japan, presumably by Japanese people, Japanese workers somewhere in the Toyota city or somewhere else. The other possibility is to take the word Japanese to mean the same thing as in the compound Japanese food. Japanese food is a specific kind of food which can be made everywhere in the world, not just in Japan, and by everybody, not just the Japanese people. So is Japanese philosophy like a Japanese car or like Japanese food? If it would be the Japanese car, then we could say that Japanese philosophy is, let's say, Western-type philosophy practiced by the Japanese people. Like currently we have, Kogubun Koichiro and Japanese Deleuzians and so on. But if we say it is like Japanese food, it would mean that I too could practice Japanese philosophy, like, for example, engaging with texts by Dogen and others, and enabling or adopting the methods or their kind of thinking or delving into that, then what I do, even I'm an Estonian living in Estonia, would be Japanese philosophy as well. So in both cases, the term Japanese philosophy, so defined, would cut out a certain proportion of what we would naively assume to be Japanese philosophy. Because if it's a Japanese food way, then Kokubun Koichiro's philosophy is not Japanese philosophy, it's French philosophy in Japan. If it is the Japanese car way, then you could put forward arguments to say, well, Dogen's work or Kukai's work is not philosophy, because philosophy is something that we have defined according to Western criteria. Both ways of thinking are legitimate. You can present arguments in favor of both kinds. I personally prefer the Japanese food interpretation, but I can understand how the other interpretation can also be defended.
Would you like to add something,
sure.
John?
Yes, I'd like to hear from all of us about that, but I think this is a very good question. It's a fun question. Is the Japanese of Japanese philosophy like cars or like food? And this is somewhat similar to the distinction between Japanese philosophy and philosophy in Japan. Philosophy in Japan can be everything that contemporary, mostly academic philosophers practice, so they can do French philosophy, or just as Americans do French philosophy and French do French philosophy and so forth. But I think that I would say that Japanese philosophy is like both Japanese cars and Japanese food. Japanese cars, for example, are made In the United States, probably also in Europe, and not only in Japan. Just 100 miles from where I live in the state of Indiana, Toyota Tundras are made. And of course, the parts might come from all over the world, but that's the case with Japanese cars in Japan as well. And so that's an important point. That would mean analogously that people all over the world can do Japanese philosophy. They can practice it in the sense that you were speaking earlier about the importance of doing philosophy and not just professionally studying it. On the other hand, Japanese food is also, as you point out, something that is not only eaten, but made, produced, created all over the world. Here in Brussels, we can go to a Japanese restaurant and find perhaps Belgium, French cooks of Japanese food, and or you can make it at home yourself. So in Japan, also you can have a Japanese version of Italian food. I think that Japan was the only place that I had supposedly Italian spaghetti with ketchup on top for its sauce. So it's
in America,
yes, yeah, right. In any case, I would say that in a good sense, it really is like both the cars and the food. And the important part here is that outside of Japan, and non-Japanese can do Japanese philosophy. That's what I would say about it.
Professor
Isamu,
would you like to add something about this?
I have understood under the name, under the concept of disarmament, very narrow. No meaning, only the activity of education of philosophy in university. So I cannot define any specialty in Japan. Therefore, I have very anxious about the future of philosophy in the world. So I want to emphasize the academic and hermeneutical training of philosophical texts, especially in the education of university is emphasis.
I have a question to Professor Raud again.
Well, I'm very much impressed that you know Kokubun Koichiro, even Kokubun Koichiro in Japan. But I wonder if there's any the kind of counterpart part in Europe or in America, the philosopher or philosopher who is practicing in Japanese, doing philosophy with Japanese means to some European end or somebody or like that.
Would you give a concrete example?
Well, not Japanese, but there is a Chinese philosopher working in France and in French who is François Julien. I think his case proves that this is not impossible.
Well, I've got some doubt about it because the philosophical language is through and through European, I think. In Thomas Kasuli's term, integrity oriented, rather the Japanese case is integrity oriented. He wrote, the Kasuli's, for instance, wrote his work in integrity principle. He couldn't write in intimacy principle. And so I wonder if there is any typical instance in which the philosophy per se is conducted in a Japanese way.
I'm not quite convinced that this holds for Kasuli's book, Intimacy and Integrity. I think he's trying to combine both of these languages in that very book as well. So he has a kind of, I would say that at the best moments in the book, he uses intimacy, the intimacy language in order to tackle the topics of integrity and approach
intimacy with the means of an integrity language, which makes it such a great achievement. I wouldn't say that the book is completely sort of integrity-based analytical work at all.
Well, further on, may I ask, is there any philosopher, European or American philosopher, doing in the Dawkins way?
No, but I would not make. I would not say that this would be an impossibility. Further on, we have noted a few subterranean influences in the European tradition of the 20th century. For example, Heidegger has been exposed to have borrowed from his Japanese students and his engagements with Chinese texts more substantially than anyone could be allowed to borrow without references in today's world. Also, I have discovered a passage in Albert Camus' The Myth of Sisyphus, which is almost verbatim from a paper that Kuki Shuzo delivered in France when he was staying there. So we have, like, you know, this kind of traffic. But the other problem is the sort of hostile attitude reigning in Western academic disciplines and the way how philosophy is practiced in today's world, which disqualifies you as a philosopher as soon as you try to venture off the well-trodden path of what philosophy is. So if you want to be employed, you have to be following the rules of the guild, and that means you can't write like Dogen. If you start writing like Dogen, you're disqualified as a philosopher. You may actually do better philosophy than most of the people in philosophy departments do, but you're not counted as a philosopher. You're an essayist or a fiction writer or a guru or whatever, but your work is no longer considered philosophy. I think this is a serious problem, and we should address that. We should try to broaden. We should try to contribute to the broadening of the generic borders of the discipline of philosophy, so that more ways of philosophizing or philosophical thinking would be legitimate.
Please, John.
I think that one of the ways that we might broaden the horizons of philosophy is to sort of cut back a little bit on this division between East and West in Japanese and non-Japanese, and try to see, for example, well, Dogen, how many other Japanese philosophers in Japan thought and wrote like Dogen, or how many other Buddhists? Very few. How about the contemporary ones? What about Nishida? Since most of his references and allusions are to Western philosophers, and the ones to his indebtedness to the philosophers of Japan and the East are just as hidden as Heidegger's Eastern sources, I think, for maybe cultural reasons. I'm not sure we could give Heidegger that excuse. But Heidegger, for me, would count as, if you want to divide up the world into intimacy thinkers and integrity thinkers, he's an intimacy thinker. He works more in terms of internal relations than external relations. And certainly there are philosophers in Japan who are use more external relations or an integrity kind of framework. So the world doesn't really, I think, reduce to West versus East very easily anymore. And so I think it's really important. I mean, at some point we need to put East and West to rest. Maybe this isn't the time, because many of you here are going to be fighting for your livelihood in representing so-called Eastern Asian or Japanese philosophy in wherever you teach, philosophy departments, Asian studies departments, Japanese studies departments. And so your livelihood may require you to divide up in the world, at least tentatively that way. But eventually we do have to broaden the horizons and say, these categories also no longer fit.
For example, also if you take later texts by Emmanuel Levinas, an intimacy thinker par excellence, I would say, with the otherwise than being and so on. And so what we are striving for is like California sushi, yeah? Even though I don't like California sushi very much, but I mean the food. But the equivalent to the in philosophy would very much be appreciated. And I think recently Ralf Weber and some other people published a book which is entitled Fusion Philosophy, and like Infusion Kitchen. And I would say that this is what we should be aiming at, a kind of fusion of different ways to philosophize and an impartial, unimpeded exploitation of the heritage of the whole philosophical multitude of philosophical traditions worldwide in order to create new understanding. And since Japanese philosophy is in a privileged position of having started the dialogue from the side of Japan earlier than other such traditions, then Japanese philosophy is in a certain key position here because precisely because of the work of Nishida and Kyoto school thinkers who kind of like opened it up, making it possible also later for like Sarvabhauma Radhakrishnan or Chinese modern thinkers to kind of engage with their own tradition and with the Western tradition at the same time.
Okay. Well, just as a concluding remarks, perhaps from every of you, I would like to ask why and how. Why is it so difficult to accept this variety of philosophies? Because you talk about Japanese food, for example. So Japanese art, Japanese literature has been accepted worldwide as a literature or art. Why in philosophy we are taking this discussion once and again? Oh. Why so hard?
By the way, this is not something that has happened easily and at the same and immediately. The first ever history of Japanese literature in English was published by someone called William Aston in, I think, 1894, which basically says, oh, the Japanese really don't have any literature. Yeah? They have like scribbled something which is of almost no value. So Japanese poetry, just rubbish, don't even bother. And it took like a bit, like maybe 20, 30 years before Japanese poetry started to be one of the major influences in modernist European poetry. The same thing, you know, like you have 19th century people pronouncing that Africa doesn't have any art, and then a few decades go by and you have all kinds of avant-garde movements heavily influenced by African art. So it's just like it's a kind of a period that has to be gone through.
Perhaps it's now the moment for philosophy.
Yes, it is.
Okay, and how? My last question, what do you recommend us to help to improve this situation? And what would you do to the Westernizing Philosophical Forum to take the expression by James Heisek?
Well, as you were present and John was present in a meeting that was organized in Tallinn a bit earlier this year, we tried to do something precisely like that. We had a meeting of philosophies, who called that. We had five people who were engaged with Japanese philosophy, and five people, among them a specialist in Greek philosophy, a Deleuzian, a quantum physicist, a neuroscientist, and an ethics professor. working in the Western traditions. We're like paired together in five sessions with short introductions and about 2 hours of debate each time. And what happened that was that the people in Western traditions became like more and more interested in Japanese philosophy, and not just as a curiosity, but as something that they consider really relevant for their own work. Small step, but yeah, well, that's something we can do.
Would you like to hear also other participants?
So, when we're here in a conference like this, we don't need to justify our interests to one another. When you go home, wherever you work, PhD students or teachers or both, often you're in the position of justifying what you do, which is not bad. It's okay. You need to show what you do to people outside of Asian philosophy even. You need to go to conferences that are not specifically devoted only to, say, Japanese philosophy or Asian and comparative philosophy, but try to go present your work at other venues and show that way the relevance of what you're doing.
Well, but talking of, if we talk philosophers in Japan, they usually designate specialists, lovers of, professional lovers of Western philosophy, although they don't earn much money like prostitutes. And I'm really surprised in a way that the concept Japanese philosophy itself has come from abroad like a black sheep in the later period, and the shock is not, so far as I can see, is not enough, and it's rather ironical to for a simple Japanese to ask you who are interested in Japanese philosophy to continue pressure to the mainland Japan about the importance of Japanese philosophy. And the time has come, perhaps, to promote this kind of project in mainland. And I'm really grateful, and I'd like to express my heartfelt respects to Western specialists on Japanese philosophy, especially frontiers like John Maraldo and James Heisig, and etc. And but as again, a simple Japanese, I'm not a philosopher, just a jack of all trade and trades, and studied as literature specialist now, and found having found a very good niche called Japanese philosophy. I just grabbed it, but as a amateurish Japanese philosopher, I'd like you to think again the what we call Japanese philosophy is yet to be formed, and particularly 20th century Japanese philosophy is really roughly made. And what I'm referring to is, for instance, when we talk about Kyoto School in that sense should include Tosaka Jun, like Marxist materialist, who severely criticized Nishida and Watsujin, etc. And so this kind of reformation of Japanese philosophy is particularly in need. And it's really encouraging to see you all, and particularly younger generation, interested in Japanese philosophy. And I'd like to thank you. On behalf of Japanese Emperor, I'd like to thank you all.
So, I want to some very paradoxical situation of our University. I belong to the Department of Philosophy, not Japanese philosophy, not Western or Orient. The name of Department of Philosophy, the philosophy means only Western philosophy. That's a very ironical. We have any original philosophy. Not yet. So for example, in the Kyoto University, the Department of Japanese Philosophy began. So professor and students have studies the so-called Japanese philosophy only modern and since Meiji era. So this is a very paradoxical, ironical situation. So we have not yet. Japanese people not yet have our own philosophy. I believe that so. But in the in the very wide sense, my philosophy in the wide sense we have already have. But the system of education of university, seems to me very not yet good, complete. I think.
Okay, thank you very much for concluding. We have learned, reflect on many different things. We heard from Professor Yasunari Tanaka about what influence in Japanese modernity, modern philosophy, the Greek dialectics, analytic dialectics we mentioned, the Christian transcendent aspirations, modern process of secularization. And also we heard from Professor Yasunari Tanaka about the potential criticism that is in Nishida's thinking about his own culture and perhaps a way to answer our question about cultural disarmament of philosophy, but inside Japanese debate. We learn also from Professor Rein to think philosophically, not just doing history of philosophy, and about the potential in Japanese philosophy to help marginal voices in Western philosophical landscapes to create discourses more adequate with the results of natural sciences. And to conclude also with the Maraldo words at the beginning, we need more integration inside our departments, inside the university departments, but also outside, and not word talk, said Professor Maraldo, but to explore more what we are doing and what we are trying to do. So thank you very much, all the participants, for attending and engaging in this discussion. Thank you to you all for being here and listening and asking questions. And a big clapping for ending the session, please.